The topic of this class is reading Revelation as a Jewish text. I don't know how many of you have done this before or thought about doing this before, but this is easier said than done sometimes. There are some foundational things that I would like to lay down for you before we get into the context of Revelation. Basic facts. What are the kinds of things that I need you to know as we're studying Revelation? Well, first fact is that Revelation is a traditional Jewish apocalyptical text, and it speaks to readers via symbols and heavenly visions through cultural images and codes aimed at insider audience. Please understand that Revelation is not easy to read because it speaks the language of insiders, and unless you are going to become insiders, it's going to be hard to make sense of what in the world it's talking about. So, Revelation chapter 5, for example, verses 5 and 6, we read this, "And I saw between the throne the four living creatures, and the elders, and a lamb standing as if slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God, sent out into all the earth." So the big question is it a lamb or is it the seven spirits of God? Is it the lamb with seven eyes and seven horns, or the seven horns and seven eyes represent the seven spirits of God? Is this speaking literally? Is it speaking figuratively? This is where people are usually lost. And so again, the imagery detracts because people have no idea what it has to do with anything that the book of Revelation is actually saying. So, how can a lamb be standing if it's slain? If it is slain or something like that. So, what do the horns represent? What does the lamb represent? All of these are cultural images that are based on particular context to which a lot of people have no idea how to connect. So it is an apocalyptical text, and if you want to find the answer of what these things mean, you have to search through Jewish apocalyptical texts of similar variety to find those answers. So the second point that I wanted to share with you is that Revelation expresses anti-Roman sentiments. What I mean by that is that the text enters into a polemic with the paganism of Roman Empire. I mean, who has not imagined, you know, the whore of Babylon, you know, riding on that beast in the book of Revelation? Well, here's a beautiful image here for you that comes straight out of what we call the Luther Bible. This is 1534 published Bible. This is what he visualized the whore of Babylon looking like. Obviously for Luther, it was the Catholic Church, which is why the lady riding the beast looks a lot like, you know, she's wearing some sort of a royal priestly attire, you know, some nobility from that period. But, you know, when you read this, Revelation 17, verses 1 through 9, it says, "I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters." Why is she sitting on many waters? What does that mean? "I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her." So the woman is some sort of a mysterious woman, and the beast is as well, "which has seven heads and ten horns." What does that mean? The seven heads, says that passage, are the seven mountains on which the woman sits. If you are a student of the historical period of that era when the book of Revelation was written, the idea of woman sitting on seven mountains will not evade you. Maybe for medieval commentators that means absolutely nothing, but for first century people that means a lot. Woman who sits on seven mountains is none other than Roma herself, the goddess of Rome. And so this is what I mean, that when the book of Revelation has a polemical relationship with the paganism of Rome, it is the Rome itself that is harlot, and that's what essentially the book is talking about. So while Luther thought about Catholic Church, you know, obviously that was his battle. That was his windmill, if you want to think of the Cervantes language. But essentially, we are talking about language of the first century, and that's more important. What did it mean to the original audience rather than what does it mean to us in our political or social situation? So another point to remember as you read the book of Revelation is that Revelation is a real letter. And what I mean is it is a public message to seven very real, very historical assemblies of Christ followers who are undergoing persecution. It is not a letter written to me and you. It is a letter written to the congregations that existed. It has to make sense to them, first and foremost. If it makes no sense to them, whatever sense it makes to you and I is irrelevant, because the letter wasn't written to some distant generations necessarily as the first primary audience, but it was written to those people who were going through terrible persecutions. And number four is that Revelation is a prophetic message. Israel's prophets always rebuked sin and always proclaimed future hope. And that's what the book of Revelation is going to be. In like manner, it's going to have warnings to those who go astray and, you know, people who move toward paganism. And it will talk about offering rewards and bright future and praise for the faithful who persevere through all the persecutions and remain faithful to the God of Israel. And then points number five and number six quickly is that Revelation is about first century events. That's important to keep in mind. The author says that his visions will come to pass, quote, very soon. If you read Revelation 1:1 and 22:6, that is exactly what you will encounter. That's the language. So the message was intended to be fully understood and fully embraced by the first century believers. Again, there should be no mystery for the first century believers in the book of Revelation. If they don't get it, then neither should we. Because according to John, it is something that was supposed to happen in their day, very soon. And point number six is, of course, Revelation is about future events as well. And John does not hide that. He does not veil that. He tells you that these visions are of future events. And of course, just as prophecy included future predictions, so does Revelation. But the core of the message is focused on the time at hand. Revelation is, of my opinion, is largely about first century events, and future is certainly a part of the message, but not the biggest part of that message.